Okay. A little over a year ago, in September of 2020, the world's oldest living billionaire, at that point, passed away. At the time, he was 102 years old. He became the oldest living billionaire in 2017 when David Rockefeller passed away. His name was Chang Yun Chung. Don't say that five times fast. He certainly had the resources to live the life that he chose. I mean, if you had that kind of money, you could too, you know. But that being the case, can you guess what it was that he chose to do every day of his life until he passed away? Any guesses? He went to work. He was the founder of Pacific International Lines, which is a shipping company. And until 2018, he was the executive chairman of the company. And in late 2018, when he was 99 years old, he modified his job title and his role. He turned his operations over to one of his sons, but he was still involved in the daily operations and the key decisions that went on at the company. And he checked in every day with the head of every department. He said that work was not really an optional activity. He said, "I cannot stay at home. I'd get very, very bored." Now, I would imagine that there are a lot of people who can't really understand that kind of thinking. I think most people would say, you know, if I had $1 billion, I think each day I could find something pretty interesting to do that didn't involve punching some kind of a time clock. In fact, there are probably quite a few folks who are ready and willing to embrace the slightest excuse for not having to go to work at all. What I've discovered is that this attitude isn't simply a sign of laziness as much as it's indicative of a lack of a clear-cut, well-defined sense of purpose. When you have a purpose, you'll pursue it every day of your life, whether it pays a little, whether it pays a lot, whether it doesn't pay anything at all. Your purpose in life includes your job, to some extent at least. It also includes many other things, such as your family, your volunteer work, your spiritual life. And when you do it right, it's all-encompassing. We're in the second week of this little series of sermons about the ones, the number ones, that are in Scripture. The basics that we're looking at is how to experience the power of intentional living. Last week, we talked about living a one Lord lifestyle because you can't serve two masters. Today, we're going to be talking about living your life with one primary purpose, one objective that supersedes everything else. Now, I wish that I could tell you in a very short 30-second soundbite exactly what your purpose is and how you need to put it into practice. But that's not really how it works. Your life purpose is something that you have to discover through the process of your journey through life. Unfortunately, it's not a one-size-fits-all type of thing. It's custom-made just for you. And it ties into your career, if you're still working, ties into your family, your church life, basically every other area that's a part of your life. And so today I want to look at some guidelines that you can consider that might help you to discover and refine what your life's purpose is. We're going to be mainly in 2 Thessalonians in chapter 1. If you want to turn there. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. The church in Thessalonica was a church that Paul said set an example for churches everywhere. He said, in effect, you're doing it right in spite of the hardships, in spite of the obstacles and persecutions that are coming your way. He said in Ephesians, or 2 Ephesians 1, verse 4, he said, therefore, we ourselves boast about you among God's churches, about your endurance and faith in all the persecutions and afflictions that you endure. And then toward the end of that chapter, down in verses 11 and 12, this is where we're going to be focusing today, verses 11 and 12, it says, and in view of this, we always pray for you that our God will consider you worthy of his calling and will, by his power, fulfill every desire for goodness and the work of faith, so that the name of our Lord Jesus Christ will be glorified by you and you by him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. So tonight I want us to take a look at three ideas related to finding your life's purpose. And here's the first idea that I want you to think about. You have a calling to live up to. You have a calling to live up to. Now, I know that J.R. has mentioned this before. I would imagine that I've said it at least once at some point over the years here. But it's not just preachers who get the call, if you will. It's people of all types. It's not just missionaries. It's also ordinary men and women. No matter who you are, God has called you in a specific direction towards a specific purpose. If you're working, then your current job is most likely a part of that calling. It may not be his long-term plan for your life. Maybe he's just preparing you now for something different that's going to be coming along. But the job you have today is a part of that calling. There were times in my ministry when I found myself working bivocationally, when I had to supplement my income with another job. One of those times was when I was working for the lobbyist in Topeka. At the time, I thought it was simply a way to earn the money I needed in order to live. If you'd asked me while I was working there if God was working through me, I'm not really sure what answer I would have given you at that point. Because for the last half of the time that I worked there, I was miserable. Just, I hated it. However, looking back now, I know that God was using me there and he was preparing me for a lot of the situations and a lot of the people that I was going to be facing in churches to come. We have a calling, and Paul is challenging us to live up to it, to be worthy of it. In today's text, he said, look at the very first part of verse 11. It says, we always pray for you that our God will consider you worthy of his calling. He's talking about living up to it, just like he was in the book of Ephesians. In Ephesians 4:1, he said, therefore I, the prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk worthy of the calling you have received. I firmly believe that God's calling for our lives is always just a little bit bigger, a little bit better, many times a little bit tougher than the one that we would choose for ourselves. We have a tendency to be much easier on ourselves. Some people pick their life pursuit based on what the path of least resistance is. What can I do without breaking much of a sweat? Unfortunately, I think That's kind of where Jeremy's at this point. But God's calling challenges us to be a little better than we currently are. That's why Paul doesn't say, you know what, just coast through life the way you want. Instead, he says, walk worthy. Hold yourself to a higher standard. When any temptation comes along, the temptation to coast, the temptation to compromise, the temptation to just phone it in, the temptation to yield to sinful desire, when any temptation comes along, we need to learn to say, I'm better than that. God has called me to something greater than a life of laziness, or a life of mediocrity, or a life of disobedience. I'm better than that. God has placed His calling on your life, and His calling begins wherever you are right now. The job you have today may not be your forever job, but He wants you to pursue your work with excellence. If you're single, He may not intend for you to be single forever, but He wants you to live the single life with integrity. You may not be doing all that you want to be doing with your life right now, but He wants you to do whatever it is that you're doing today with a spirit of excellence. Colossians 3:23 says, "Whatever you do, do it enthusiastically, as something done for the Lord and not for men." A different translation says it this way, "Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for men." So you have a calling. Each of us has a calling to live up to. And it starts right where we're at, right now. A second part of the process of living out your purpose is to recognize that you have some big plans to pursue. Each of us have some big plans to pursue. Another way to say this is that you have some big ideas to consider, or some good intentions upon which you need to follow through on. Paul said that he prays for the believers in Thessalonica. Look at the last part of verse 11. It says, "And will, by His power, fulfill every desire for goodness and the work of faith." The New Living Translation says it this way, "May He give you the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to do." I like that one. I like that translation. And here's a large part of determining what your purpose is, what your life purpose might be. As you look at the world around you, which opportunity, which unmet need, which possibility most captures your attention and ignites your imagination? Chances are that this is a central part of the calling that God has placed on your life. Naturally, music is a very big part of our family. Don drives back and forth to town 5 days a week, at least 5 days a week. She listens on the radio. Well, right now she's listening to the Christmas Cantata. But normally, she listens to KSWP, Christian station. And so Don helps support them financially every month with a small donation. That's a part of the purpose that she feels that she's supposed to do. Before I went into the ministry, I was attending the church that I grew up in. Our youth and music minister switched positions and became the associate pastor at the church. Gave up youth, gave up music, and became the associate pastor. And that left an opening in the music. And so while the church began looking for a music minister, one of the women in the adult choir who had a music degree started working with the adult choir and led our worship times together with the congregation. And at that point, I had no training at all in music. I couldn't even read music at that point. I was working for the Wichita Park Department. I was cutting grass in parks and doing things. But I had a very big voice. I know that's hard for you to believe. And I was still in, even though I had graduated from high school, I was still in the youth choir. And I certainly knew all the youth that were there. And so they came to me and asked whether I would be willing to lead the youth choir during this period of time. At the very first rehearsal, as I flapped my arms and directed the youth choir, I knew that that is what I was supposed to do for the rest of my life. I thought, before any of that happened, I thought I was going to be working for the park board. I was going to be doing landscaping for the rest of my life. But as soon as I stood in front of those group of about 30 kids, 30 youth, and started directing them the very first time, I knew immediately that that's what God wanted me to do for the rest of my life. I could go on and on telling you about people that I know, school teachers, healthcare professionals, even some accountants, construction workers, who have pursued their life's work or their volunteer ministry because of an opportunity to do good captured their attention. Theologian Frederick Buchner said this: "The place God calls you to is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet." Let me read that again. The place God calls you to is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. This may determine what you do or did for a career. It may determine what you do after work. But it will certainly determine how you spend your time and where you spend your money and what your priorities will ultimately become. I've taught lessons before in churches on spiritual gifts. And one of the things that I've always told people during that study, in fact, usually several times during that study, is that it's very difficult to discover what your spiritual gift is if you don't ever do anything in the church. I knew a man who, much later in his life, was asked to teach his Sunday school class. The teacher was going to be gone, and the teacher asked him whether he would teach his Sunday school class that next week. And the man was a little hesitant because he had never done that before in his life. He had never taught. But he reluctantly said, "Okay, yeah, I'll teach next week." And he taught the next week, and the people loved it. And he found that he loved it. And he went on to become a teacher in his own class and was extremely popular. People loved sitting under him and hearing him teach them. I believe that it was one of his spiritual gifts, was teaching. But he didn't know it because he had never put himself out there in a position where he actually ever taught. So he had a spiritual gift. And it wasn't until much later in his life that he discovered that he had that gift because he had never done it. So a key question to determine your life purpose is to ask, what good thing is my faith prompting me to do? And here's the third element of living your life's purpose. In today's text, Paul uses a phrase that we shouldn't overlook at all. It's in that second half of verse 11. It says, "And will by his power fulfill every desire for goodness and the work of faith." So my third point here is that in order to live out God's purpose for your life, you need to understand that God's purpose can be fulfilled only through God's power. God's purpose in your life can only be fulfilled through God's power. When God called Moses to lead his people out of Egypt and into the promised land, he appeared to him in the form of a burning bush. Now, because of the serious mistakes that Moses had made in his past, including murder, he didn't think that he could do it. And he said so. And then God said, in effect, "You can do it, and you will do it, because my power is going to work through you." And in the rest of the story, we see how God came through for Moses in a mighty way. Moses was a great leader, but he couldn't have done what he did without the power of God. A few minutes ago, I talked about how God wants us to hold ourselves to a higher standard, to live up to our calling, to walk worthy of our calling. And I'll also say that God wants us to aspire to a higher level. That means that as we consider our calling, we don't ask ourselves, "What am I smart enough to do?" or "What am I talented enough to do?" Instead, we need to ask ourselves, "What is God big enough to do through me?" Someone once said it this way: we should attempt something so big that unless God intervenes, we're sure to fail. Now, that may not be the perfect way to phrase that, but I like the idea behind it. That's because whatever good idea you pursue, whether it's great or small, you need to hold fast to one fundamental truth. You can only succeed in fulfilling your calling by the power of God. That's why Paul said in Ephesians 3, verses 20 and 21, "Now to him who is able to do above and beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever." Try to do it without God's power, and you're going to end up like Moses herding sheep on the backside of a mountain. But if you live and move and work with God's power, the seas will part for you. As you consider God's calling on your life, do you find yourself feeling a little anxious about it? As if maybe it might be more than you can handle. I don't think that's a bad thing. In fact, if you don't feel that, maybe God wants you to aspire to a higher level. Maybe he wants you to reach a little further. Maybe he wants you to risk just a little bit more. God's purpose for your life. And believe me, if you've truly accepted him as your Lord and Savior, then he certainly has one for you. But it can only be fulfilled through his power. And that means he wants us to surrender to him every day, saying, "God, give me the strength to do all that you want me to do today." I wish I could tell you in specific detail all that your life's purpose entails. But that's not how it works. All I can do is give you some clues that I find in Scripture. But I'm very sure of this. As you pursue God, and as you listen to your heart and listen to His voice, He's going to capture your attention and He's going to ignite your imagination with something that's just beyond your reach, that you'll be inspired to hold yourself to a higher standard, and you'll be challenged to rely every day on His power. I began this message by telling you about the 102-year-old billionaire who went into the office every single day until he died. I find it amazing that someone could be that engaged in their life's work. And then I found the story of John Kitna. Possibly you've heard of him. He was an athlete, or is an athlete. He attended Central Washington University on a football scholarship. It's a very small school. Their players rarely end up playing football professionally. But against the odds, he was drafted by the Seattle Seahawks as a free agent in 1996. He ended up playing 16 seasons for Seattle, Cincinnati, Detroit, and Dallas. Throughout his career, he had some pretty good numbers, and he earned quite a bit of money. His final year, his final season, he earned $3 million. When he retired at the age of 40, he probably could have done anything he wanted, or he could have done nothing with what he had for the rest of his life. So what did he choose to do? He took a job teaching math and coaching football in a tough, impoverished school on the east side of Tacoma, Washington. Why would he make that choice? Could be several reasons, but the most significant was that while he was attending college, he made a decision to accept Christ as his Savior. His parents, who had previously been non-religious, also accepted Christ. He's held a lot of different positions over the years, but he said in an interview with his wife that they both live with a sense of purpose. He said, "We don't believe that we've been given all that we've been given to just enjoy a comfortable life." Living your life with a sense of purpose, finding that place where your deep gladness meets the world's deep hunger, that's our one purpose. Many people are driven by the desire to create an easier life. John Kitna is driven by the desire to create a meaningful life for himself and for his students in Burleson, Texas, right now, where he teaches and coaches today. And every day, his message to the kids that he teaches is there's greatness in these halls. And that goes for us as well. There's greatness in this room. God has a purpose for you. If you're ready to reach, He's ready to help you fulfill all the good things that your faith prompts you to do. God's purpose for your life can begin tonight, right where you are. Hold yourself to a higher standard. Look for opportunities to do good and surrender yourself to His power for His glory. next week, we'll be looking at the one love that we should have. Take out your prayer sheets, if you would.